Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Resurrection, a Lit RPG Adventure by D.M. Hermakowski. Narrated by Paul Boehmer. Prologue. June 6th, 2065. Ryan Jennings realized they were in trouble as soon as the alarms started blaring. As the sudden whirring sirens engulfed them, his wife and son came to a dead stop just ahead of him, in a digitally rendered landscape where the grassy field and the blue sky looked utterly real. His family waited for his reaction. He glanced at the other families who, moments before, had been enjoying the day. They stood frozen, shocked by the sudden turn of events. Ryan ran to his son Mike, who looked up at him, already disappointed. Mike had been anticipating this trip for months, celebrating his 16th birthday at Epiphany 16, the new state-of-the-art virtual game world. Ryan felt Olivia's hand close around his. "Honey, what is going on?" Before he could answer, the people around them bolted for the portal. Ryan threw aside his medieval sword and grabbed Mike's hand. "We have to get out of here. Now!" His son's hand pulled away. "Ah, Dad, it's nothing," Mike protested. "This is probably a gimmick. They want you to fall for it." Ryan shook his head furiously. "No. It was in the liability waiver they forced us to sign. If the alarms go off, we have to evacuate to the nearest portal immediately." Mike sagged. Ryan felt sorry for Mike, but he knew the situation was urgent. He had read every word of the liability waiver. It was a disgusting document that absolved Cloud9 systems of all damages. When he'd read about the sirens, Ryan had wanted to abandon their plans and head back to Boston, but Mike had been so stubborn about spending his weekend at Epiphany 16 that Ryan finally relented. He cursed himself for it now. A man collided with Mike, knocking him to the ground. Enraged, Ryan turned to scream at him. "No time for that," he thought. "Don't get distracted. Get them out of here." He picked up his son and held his arm, then reached for his wife, Olivia. "Lucky for us, we didn't get too far into the realm," Ryan thought. "We're maybe 10 minutes away from the portal." He started running, pulling Olivia and Mike with him. "Ouch!" Olivia complained as he jerked her arm, but she raced along with him.
"Get moving, Mike!"
Ryan shouted. They sprinted through the tall grass as swarms of people fled past them, their eyes wild with fear. The alarms blaring overhead reminded Ryan of the nuclear test sirens he would hear as a kid. "Where are the sirens coming from?" he wondered. There were no speakers in sight, and yet the sound enveloped them. They were breathing heavily now. Sweat coated Ryan's skin. He glanced at Olivia. Her light brown hair clung to her damp skin. He concentrated on the portal ahead. "Just another 100 yards, he estimated. The portal bounced in his vision as they ran. He saw people leaping through the portal like they were diving into a swimming pool. "That's going to make for a hard land." Through his ringing ears, Ryan heard a loud, descending hum that sounded like a machine powering down. Then, abruptly, the sirens stopped and the realm turned black. A startled hush rippled through the darkness. Ryan waited for his eyes to adjust to the gloom, but they weren't adjusting. The realm was pitch black and as silent as a tomb. "I can't feel the ground," he realized suddenly. Ryan peered down and gasped. The green field was gone. They were floating in a desolate void. He noticed infinitesimal pinpricks of light, barely distinguishable, circling in the darkness. He turned to Olivia, but saw only her darkened, vague shape. Her blue eyes had transformed into black ovals. "Dad!" Mike cried, squeezing his hand. With dawning horror, Ryan realized he couldn't feel his wife's or son's skin anymore. What he felt in his hands was oily and cold. "Oh my God, have they shut the game down?" he thought. "They're not going to leave us in here, are they?" Cutting through the absence of sound were the cries of other families left behind, but Ryan couldn't see them in the darkness. On his right, he heard someone shriek. Ryan turned toward the sound, but his body remained stationary, hovering in the complete vacuum. More people were screaming now. Their desperate cries rose like a twisted chorus of human misery. "Baby, what's going on?" Olivia sobbed. Ryan gawked as black tears flowed from his wife's eyes.
I don't...
A new ascending hum flooded their ears, rising in pitch and volume, surrounding them. Pixel by pixel, Ryan saw the virtual landscape take form again. The grass below him materialized in green hues, and the sky above him shone once more. He watched in astonishment as his bones, muscles, and skin traced new lines along his recoloring body. He glanced at Olivia and saw her blue pupils redrawn over the white globes of her eyes. The people around him were numbed, silent again. In an instant that seemed to last forever, they stared at their family members in complete shock. Then someone yelled, and absolute panic ensued. The horde of people charged for the portal. Ryan, Olivia, and Mike raced with them. The surrounding families shouted and screamed. Ryan saw someone go down and get trampled by the crowd. "Dear God," he begged, "please get us through this." As they ran toward their escape, the portal ahead of them blinked out of existence. Part 1. The Secret Deal. He who fights with monsters might take care lest he thereby become a monster. And if you gaze for long into an abyss, the abyss gazes also into you. Beyond Good and Evil. Friedrich Nietzsche. Breach. January 13th, 2073. Jake stood on the porch of his rented house and watched as Senator Will Harris approached. The senator was tall and wore a slick raincoat, his head tucked in from the driving rain. Jake saw his breath drift above him in the frigid night air.
"Did you transfer the money from your private account?" Jake asked.
Yeah. It should be there now,"
Harris said, shivering.
"Where did you park?"
"I didn't. I took a telepod from the Senate chamber to Old Central Park Station."
Jake grunted. Telepods was short for teleportation pods. There were 5,000 in the U.S., and they could transfer you across the country in an instant. They were also extremely expensive to use and inaccessible to people like Jake.
"Do you have any tracking devices, any cells?" Jake asked.
"Nothing."
Jake guessed that the senator was in his early 50s. His gray hair was drenched because of the long walk from the park, yet he oddly looked out of place, grinning like he'd just won the lottery.
"No one recognized you on the way?"
Harris didn't reply. Instead, he gestured at the rain impatiently.
"Okay. Come in, then."
Jake led him to the rear entry door. and they started down the stairs to his basement. The purple glow from a single wall-mounted computer monitor was the room's only light source. Harris surveyed the room, unaccustomed to such humble surroundings. Equipment crowded the small space of the basement apartment. Computer racks, signal jammers, routers, and a pile of other hardware the senator didn't recognize. As the two men sat at a desk near the monitor, Jake picked up a wraparound ear device and fitted it onto his ear. He pulled two wires from it, each with a small pin on the end. Jake inserted the pins into the implants on the sides of his forehead. He grabbed a small gadget containing a QWERTY keypad from the desk. Jake stood and walked away from the senator.
"Account number,"
he whispered into the mic attached to his earpiece. After punching a series of numbers into the QWERTY pad, he paused, then said,
"Log out."
"Okay, the funds are there," Jake said, returning to the desk. "We're good to go. Now strip."
As Harris stripped to his shorts and socks, Jake used his earpiece to call Noel, his insider at Cloud Nine Systems. Cloud Nine dominated 95% of the global virtual game world market. That covered full-immersion worlds where the player's entire body was converted and transferred to the game environment. It also included VRMMORPGs, an acronym for Virtual Reality, Massively Multiplayer Online Role-Playing Game, which allowed players to connect with a gaming world from their homes. Jake had worked at Cloud Nine from the beginning, back when the company built the New York campus 15 years before. Previously, the only North American facilities had been in Boston, Toronto, and San Francisco. Now, the New York installation was the headquarters to all of Cloud Nine's operations. Noel wasn't answering the call.
"Where are you?"
Jake muttered. The senator looked on, concerned. Jake was about to disconnect when Noel finally answered.
Yeah, okay,"
Jake replied into the mic attached to his ear device.
"Is everything ready?"
He listened.
"And Nevin has cleared Vlad out?"
Vlad was Cloud Nine's lead engineer and the only person who could possibly thwart their plans. Jake nodded, ended the communication, and turned to the senator.
"Man, I cannot wait for this,"
Harris said, grinning.
"You're big on these retro game worlds, aren't you?"
The senator laughed.
"I'm big on everything, played on all the platforms but this one. I never thought I'd get the chance."
Jake grunted. He was beginning to loathe the senator. Captain of industry. Has played on every platform.
"Wish I had that much disposable income,"
he smirked.
"Well, now I do."
Jake tapped one of 20 small metal implanted insertion devices, better known as IIDs, that ran along the senator's body. They looked like input jacks. There were four on his head, both front and rear, three along each arm and leg, and four circling his torso and back. Because the devices had so many functions, IIDs were federally mandated. The operation would occur on your 15th birthday and was viewed as a day surgery. You were in and out within a few hours. Still, many refused the medical procedure, declaring their 33rd Amendment rights, known as the My Body Rights. Just two IIDs would determine a patient's vitals, such as blood pressure and oxygen saturation. Four pins would enable the user to interact with augmented reality programs. All 20 pins would get you a virtual, full-body massage. They were also used for full-immersion gaming, linking third-generation quantum computers with injectable, biocompatible nanoparticles.
"Are all of these IIDs functional?"
The senator grinned.
"Oh yeah, I just got back from Aurora Sky."
Jake grunted. Aurora Sky was one of the most expensive virtual game worlds, reserved solely for the powerful and financial elite.
You have nothing else that is trackable?
Nope. Clean as a whistle.
Where's your earpiece?
Back at the office.
Jake looked Harris over, carefully, searching for scars or other marks. He grabbed a handheld scanner from the equipment rack and passed it over the senator's body. No beeps.
Okay, Jake said. You can get dressed.
When the senator was ready, Jake handed him a Cloud9 baseball cap.
Would you mind wearing this? To keep people from spotting you.
Harris laughed.
I could have used this for a walk from the park.
Still wearing his earpiece, Jake grabbed his hoodie, and they walked out into the pouring rain. Jake and the senator slogged through the downpour to the Cloud9 campus.
Give me the rundown.
Jake said.
Huh?
He stopped and grabbed the senator's shoulder.
Everything you remember about Epiphany 16.
The senator appeared to be reciting something from memory.
Right. One of the first online multiplayer game worlds designed by Hiroshi Kudo and decommissioned by your gang of senators.
Jake interrupted. Harris shrugged.
Sure, but I felt the data never supported shutting it down.
The senator folded his arms. I voted against it.
What else?
Jake asked.
I can use the dedicated portals to travel to and from each realm.
Only after they've been enabled. Jake corrected, and those portals can access the landing zone if you get into trouble.
Harris laughed.
I won't get into trouble.
Jake shook his head, incensed.
Look, man, you better take this fucking seriously. I have my money, so what do I care?
Once you're in there, it's up to you. No one is babysitting you. There's no way to track your movements, and there won't be a rescue if you do get into trouble. You wanted in and you got that, but if you're not back at the landing zone in 48 hours, we're leaving you there. Understood?
The senator raised his hands. Raindrops bounced off his expensive leather gloves.
Whoa there, Sparky. I'll be fine. And I'll follow your rules, no problem.
Jake paused.
Okay, let's go.
He spun around and marched toward the campus. Jake knew Harris was wrong. The data clearly showed the aberrations which had started developing a decade ago. Congress was right to shut the project down and make it illegal. Now, 8 years later, he had no idea what it was like in there. Still, he would not turn away from the money. If the senator wanted to be a cowboy, that was on him.
What's the most important thing to remember?
Jake asked.
Harris had no trouble recalling this one.
There are no respawns. Dead is dead.
It was 6 blocks from Jake's house to the campus. Cloud9's 7 high-rise office towers loomed over them like a monolith. As they walked, Jake saw a cat dart out from under a car and away from the overflowing sewers. It ran for the safety of a dirt pathway between the tenements. These buildings dated back to before the turn of the century. Jake thought it was a sad commentary that the jewel of the Cloud9 network, with its heated swimming pool and free gym membership, had been set up in such a dump of a neighborhood. They reached the rear access security door to Tower 1. Jake pounded on its flat metal surface. After a moment, the door opened to reveal a nervous, slightly pudgy technician.
"Let us in, Noel. It ain't getting any warmer out here."
Jake grumbled. Noel stepped back. As the two men entered the stairwell, the technician appeared starstruck.
Pleased to meet you.
Jake looked incredulously at Noel, shaking his head. Harris just smiled.
Thanks.
He he replied. If we're done with the kumbaya moment, Jake grumbled, let's head up to 73. Both men stared at Jake for a long time, enough to make him feel uncomfortable. Then they turned and climbed the stairwell with Noel in the lead. Deep inside the dimly lit recesses of the seventh floor, the three men entered MCR 73. There were over 100 master control rooms throughout Tower 1. This room had an array of 40 TV screens that displayed security camera footage from a zombie virtual game world called Still Walking. In the center, one screen was black. Jake sat at the console in front of the screens and started typing code. Noel led the senator to a pod at the back of the room. The unit looked like a tanning bed without the cover. 20 wires were cradled around the pod's perimeter. Harris laughed. This is old school.
Yeah, more like ancient school. Noel replied. But it's a necessity. You can't transfer to Epiphany 16 remotely.
Noel glanced at the senator, troubled.
Sir, you do remember why they shut Epiphany down, right?
Yes, yes, yes. Harris replied impatiently. Glitches and mutations.
That's right. I've never experienced Epiphany in operation, but I've seen videos of other systems breaking down, and it is not pretty.
Harris looked at Noel apprehensively. Despite being an avid hunter with tons of gaming experience, the senator wondered whether he should continue with the trip. He understood there were risks, but knew this was his only chance to enter the fabled game world. His thoughts were interrupted when Jake called over from the console.
Okay, it's almost 8 p.m. Let's get you on that pod.
Behind Jake, the black screen in the center of the TV array was now showing Epiphany 16's landing zone. A large block of stone sat in the middle of that room. Floating above it was a luminescent, light blue orb. Harris removed his clothing and lay on the pod, shivering against the cold room.
Sorry about the temperature, Noel said. You'll be wearing clothes and armor when you get to the other side.
He started inserting the pins into the senator's IIDs.
Make sure the connections are working.
Harris joked.
I don't want to leave a leg behind.
Noel chuckled as he peeked at a monitor above the pod.
You're all green. And, by the way, that's one urban myth that isn't true.
Jake walked over from the console.
Okay. I'm ready. How about you guys?
Harris nodded. Noel gave Jake a thumbs up.
All right, Mr. Senator, Jake said.
Remain still. I'll count you in from 5. He walked back to the console and gave Noel and Harris one last glance, then started reading the countdown on his monitor.
5.
Harris took a deep breath. 4. And peered up at Noel.
3. Stay safe out there,
Noel whispered.
2.
Harris closed his eyes.
1.
An electrical buzzing noise filled the room, gaining in pitch. What followed was a rare sight for Noel, who'd never worked with the older models. Harris's body became translucent and desaturated, fluctuating only in shades of gray. Noel could see the surface of the pod behind him. Harris suddenly opened his eyes and stared at Noel. In that instant, Noel could see fear in the senator's eyes. Then the buzzing sound increased, culminating with a deafening crack. And Will Harris disappeared. A faint, burnt scent drifted up from the pod. Noel looked over at Jake, concerned.
Don't worry about the smell, Jake said.
We didn't burn the senator. That's just residual electrical gases.
The single rerouted TV screen flickered behind him, displaying the Epiphany 16 landing zone. In the center of the screen, Harris bounced excitedly, waving his sword through the air.
And he might be our next president.
Jake quipped. Noel laughed. They both breathed a sigh of relief. All the pressure building up to the transfer was gone now, and they were rich. Noel planned on leaving Cloud Nine to start a consulting firm with Jake. Meanwhile, Harris had made it over safely. He looked ecstatic as he barged through the door leading to the portal room. But it was the last time Jake or Noel ever saw the senator. While Jake terminated access to Epiphany 16, Noel meticulously arranged the wires back onto the pod.
Let's go for a dart.
Huh? Noel said. It's raining.
Not anymore, my friend.
Jake replied.
Come on, an e-cigarette to celebrate. I've got your favorite. Merlot.
Did you bring your fave?
Jake laughed.
What my girlfriend smells like, he intoned, trying to sound sophisticated.
Noel laughed this time and grinned.
You've twisted my arm.
Jake grabbed his hoodie and they rushed out of the lab. As they proceeded down the stairs, Noel took the lead again. They made quick work of the 7-floor descent, their sneakers squeaking and echoing throughout the empty stairwell. Noel heard Jake fidgeting behind him.
What in the world are you doing?
He asked.
Just preparing your wine, my friend.
Jake replied. Noel reached the main floor first. He pushed the exterior door open and stepped out into the pouring rain.
Hey, I thought you said it stopped raining,
Noel asked. He turned around to see Jake standing in front of the closed exterior door. Then he saw a glint of metal and immediately understood.
Sorry, Noel,
Jake said as he fired the gun. The Recruits. Damon. January 19th, 2073. Damon had just managed to get some shut-eye when his damned cell phone started vibrating.
Sleep had been a rare thing to come by over the last 20 years. He was used to sleeping with one eye open, but having Angie assigned to the African mission along with him had definitely improved the quality of his sleep. Crashing with a fellow soldier was part of that. The other part was sharing a bed with her again. He gazed at her outline against the moonlit sky. She was beginning to stir. He reached for his cell. The display read 1:53 a.m.
Yeah. Damon here.
He groaned.
Angie sat up, bleary-eyed, and pulled the bedspread over her chest.
Damo, it's Starkey.
Damon smacked his hand against his forehead. A call from Starkey in the middle of the night meant it was bad news. Stark never contacted him for trivial matters. When he called, it meant the mission had become complicated.
We need you back here stateside, Damo.
Stark, I just got here.
Starkey ignored the reply and didn't say a word. He waited in silence. Years ago, Damon would have raged, yelling and cursing about late changes to his mission plans. He had even more reason to be angry on this one. It was Stark who'd sent him to Africa in the first place, to take down the leaders of a religious sect who were streaming the executions of innocent people. Damon wanted this one, and he wanted to stay assigned with Angie. That was a rare opportunity. He had every right to yell at Stark. But that was the old Damon. He wasn't a rageaholic anymore. There was a lot of water under that bridge. After two ex-wives, hundreds of missions, and countless AA meetings, he knew better. He understood the eventuality of this conversation.
Fill me in.
He sighed. Cooper will assume the leadership of your team in Africa. We've arranged a flight for you to New York. Damon glanced at Angie.
I want Ange with me.
I know. She'll be on the same flight.
So what's the emergency in New York?
Starkey chuckled.
Well, let me answer you this way. Are you still a Democrat?
When Damon got off the phone with Starkey 20 minutes later, he was already decided. The payout for the mission was a huge part of that. It would be more money than he'd ever made on a single job.
Yeah, well, it's a big deal,
Angie said after being updated on some of the details.
Even I've heard of him.
Damon chuckled. He stopped packing and gazed at her on the other side of the bed. Angie had thrown on a white housecoat that, in the soft lamplight, contrasted beautifully against her cocoa skin. Damon glanced at the clock. It was 2:46 a.m. They needed to be at the Djibouti-Ambouli International Airport by 6:15 a.m., and they still had a long drive ahead of them.
Damn, not enough time, he thought.
Angie noticed his reflections, sauntered over to him, and embraced him.
Are you feeling a little unsteady, Mr. Special Operations Commander?
She teased. Damon groaned and gently pushed her away.
You are evil, Angie Richards.
She giggled and walked back to her side of the bed. As they packed, Damon filled her in on more of the phone conversation.
Stark says this virtual game world requires a full immersion transfer. It's not like plugging into a game. Your whole body is transferred there. So, we'll have to get that implant device operation.
Angie stopped zipping her knapsack.
If that's the case, I'm not going.
Damon looked up at her, puzzled.
Why not?
Because I've never been scarred in battle, she said, and I won't allow that to happen now, not for something like this.
Damon shoved the rest of his clothes into the knapsack and walked to her.
Ange, you're not getting scarred. It's just a simple procedure.
She shook her head.
Uh-uh. I'm not doing it.
Damon looked at her, exasperated. He wrapped his arms around her.
Maybe you're afraid this might force you to make a decision about us.
He prodded, trying to sway her.
You know, we could retire after this mission.
Angie peered up at him, her brown eyes sparkling. She was about to say something, then thought better of it.
Come on, Ange,
he said, gently shaking her. She remained quiet, seemingly on the edge of her decision. Angie had always been fiercely protective of him, so Damon appealed to that nature.
I'm going in, he said, and I need you there with me.
Angie stared at him a moment longer, then sighed.
Oh, all right. I'll get the damn operation.
The African sun was just rising as Damon and Angie drove east toward Camp Lemonnier, a naval base that contained the closest military airport. As their jeep bumped along the poorly maintained road, Damon glanced at the waters of the Gulf of Tajura, which gleamed a deep cerulean blue. Waves nipped at the nearby shore, glimmering with amber sunlight.
According to Stark, this virtual world is divided into 8 different triangular territories, he said. They call them realms, and each one has a unique theme, like water, earth, fire, that sort of thing.
Angie listened quietly, staring at the sunrise ahead of them. She was worried about the mission. After the hundreds of assignments that spanned both their careers, this one
was going to be a new and dangerous experience. After we get sent there, Damon continued, we'll go through the entry portal. The realm fans out and becomes wider from there. Stark thinks we'll find the senator in the first realm. He smiled at Angie.
Short and sweet.
She grunted. That remains to be seen. They struck a deep pothole, and the jeep bounced jarringly. In any case, Ange, if we don't find him quickly, there are two towers or dungeons at the end of each realm. Only one can be accessed. We can enter the second one after we've defeated the boss.
Boss? What's a boss?
Damon laughed and rubbed the stubble on his scalp.
It's sort of like the head monster.
We kill it and we're granted access to the second dungeon. There's a portal at the end of each dungeon that can transfer us back to the landing zone. Angie shifted in her seat.
It's going to be strange fighting monsters. That's not exactly something we're used to.
Damon glanced at her.
We'll be fine. I've asked Stark to recruit Zack for the mission.
Angie snorted. Zack Cassian was a Marine they'd shared tours of duty with. He was courageous and dependable, but was also the human version of a megaphone.
That should make it interesting, she said.
Damon laughed.
The other thing Stark mentioned was that this game world will affect our emotions adversely. It's called intensified emotional response, or something, and was part of the breakdown of this place. He says we'll experience heightened states of fear, sorrow, even love. So we'll have to manage our emotions, control our responses.
Angie groaned.
Damon winked at her. Just more of me to love, darling.
She laughed. They were pulling up to the airport now.
Damo, there are so many things related to this mission that we're not trained for. Maybe this isn't such a good idea.
He scoffed.
Ah, we've been through worse. It's just a game.
The Recruits. Harper.
Harper heard the banging at her door, but she chose to ignore it. After working all week at the subway, this was her one day off. Her game was Nuclear Knights, and there was money to be made, a lot of money. It surprised her how many people signed up for these elite gaming tournaments with absolutely no hope of winning. Meanwhile, the pot kept building, and since the government wasn't forgiving student debt anytime soon, Harper continued playing. IID wires snaked from her gaming chair to the 20 inputs on her body. Some were nestled in her shoulder-length brown hair, others were buried under her clothes. Her game screen lay somewhere between her brain's frontal and occipital lobe, rendering game visors obsolete. She took out the veteran players first, allowing the newbies to fight among themselves. Just two veteran players remained. After that, the noobs would be easy pickings. Harper pressed a button on the side of her earpiece.
Silo, you want to team up?
She asked, reclining in her gaming chair.
Team up?
Ha ha! Yeah, right, in your dreams.
Come on, man. Bigfoot has got you overpowered. Let's join forces and take him out.
Harper grinned. Then you and I can square off for the pot. What do you say? Silo silently contemplated the offer. Harper knew him as an English dude living in Liverpool. Nice guy. More importantly, another college grad in need of money.
Okay, you're on,
he replied. Good choice, Silo. They turned their plasma beams onto Bigfoot as Harper heard more banging on her door.
What is going on? She wondered. Is that...
Her thoughts were interrupted by Bigfoot.
Asta, what are you doing? Let's you and I team up, he pleaded.
Asta was her name on Nuclear Nights. It was short for her avatar name, Hasta la Vista Baby, a pop culture reference that hardly anyone got anymore.
Sorry, Bigfoot, I got bills to pay.
No!
Bigfoot cried. Bigfoot was short for Bigfoot Bjorn, a single dad living in Seattle, trying to make ends meet like everyone else.
This one's for you, Megan, she said.
Megan had been her sister for 12 years. They loved art and had grown up wanting to be graphic designers, but only Harper would make it to college. Megan was diagnosed with cancer, and the disease took her life 1 year later.
For my baby sister,
Harper said thickly. As Bigfoot's hit points depleted now, she knew it was time to gear up for Silo. After she won the pot, she'd donate 20% to the American Cancer Society, as usual, and keep the rest for her bills. A loud, splintering noise drowned out her game audio, and before Harper could react, a pair of cold hands started pulling the IIDs from her body. Harper spun around and saw a female police officer leaning over her. The officer reached for the wires buried beneath her shirt. She pushed the police officer away.
Get your grubby hands off of me, she shouted. I can pull these off myself, now that you have completely ruined my game.
The officer backed off. As Harper removed her IIDs, she looked at her apartment door. The lock was busted, and the door was hanging askew. A man in a business suit stood nearby, holding a crowbar.
Hey! I'm going to have to pay for that damage, she yelled. What the hell?
The man in a suit raised the crowbar like a weapon.
We will take care of that, he said dismissively. Are you Harper Benson?
Harper felt a shiver crawl down her spine. She studied the two strangers standing in her apartment. They looked angry and impatient.
Are you Harper Benson?
Business suit asked, louder this time. She gulped.
Yes.
He smiled at her.
Then we have an offer for you.
Business suit sat on Harper's couch next to her, while the police officer tried to pry her door back into place. He gazed from the woman back to Harper.
That woman knows nothing about what we will discuss, and it must remain that way.
He whispered close to her ear. Harper shrugged.
Okay.
The man removed a folded letter from the inside of his suit jacket and handed it to Harper.
Here is what we are offering you,
he said. Harper gazed at the letter, and her jaw dropped. Beneath the Cloud9 emblem was a generous retirement pension. She gaped at the man, who just nodded.
Oh my God,
she whispered as she started to feel both giddy and lightheaded. At the same time, it scared her.
What is it you want me to do for this?
The man shook his head and held up the palm of his hand.
We are offering you a choice,
he said. You can have the pension, effective immediately. Or you could have a permanent full-time job with Cloud9 designing our game worlds.
She gasped.
Both options appealed to her,
but there had to be a catch. She could feel a sense of trepidation creep in on her.
Harper swallowed.
Like I asked, what do I have to do for this?
Business suit smiled at her.
I can't tell you anything until you have signed this,
he said as he pulled a second letter from his jacket. Written across the top were the words, Non-Disclosure Agreement. As Harper read over the legalese, Business Suit decided to make conversation.
So you're a game tournament champion, I hear.
She glanced up at the man, annoyed.
Is he trying to distract me from reading this?
She wondered.
Harper went back to the letter. She had seen NDAs before, and they usually amounted to the same thing. Breathe a word about anything, and the corporation gets to pound you into a fine pulp. God, I hate reading legal stuff. But she knew she couldn't afford a lawyer, either. Harper made herself read the document, grinding through each word.
I understand you have no immediate family.
Business suit interrupted again. Anyone who might notice if you were missing for a few days. Harper felt the blood rush to her head.
Do you mind? She said hotly. I am trying to read this.
The female police officer glanced over. Business suit raised his hands.
Sorry, go ahead.
Harper tried to concentrate on the NDA, but her anger made comprehension more difficult.
Fuck it, she fumed. They're all the same.
She slammed the paper onto her coffee table. Okay, I'll sign it. Business suit grinned and shook his head.
First, I want you to answer my question.
Harper's fury rose again. She suddenly felt hot and tugged her shirt to let some air cool her chest.
What question?
The man cleared his throat.
Do you have any immediate family we don't know about?
She looked at the man, bewildered for a moment.
No! No, they're all dead! She yelled.
Business suit smiled.
Sign. Then I will tell you more.
Business suit and the cop left 30 minutes later. By then, Harper had tentatively agreed to be part of a rescue mission.
She couldn't help but laugh at the idea.
The man told her she'd join a 10-member team that would be transferred to the banned and corrupted Epiphany 16 realms. Then, the search would begin. He informed her that many of Epiphany's fail-safes no longer worked. Pain filtration was non-existent, and her emotions would be intensified.
Oh, yeah,
she whispered to her empty apartment.
And I can die there.
Harper had known about Epiphany 16. There was a whole subculture of gamers who followed the records of these early game world iterations. Details about Epiphany were well-guarded corporate secrets, but over the years, some info had leaked through the digital grapevine. And if that information was accurate, Harper knew she was taking a big chance. She'd heard stories that chilled her to the bone, tales of crippling deformity, permanent hallucinogenic states, and eventual institutionalization. Business suit had told her she would get the pension or the job even if they didn't find Senator Will Harris.
All you have to do is try,
he said reassuringly. Harper scoffed at the thought now.
Try and die,
she muttered. She walked into her bedroom and flicked on the light switch. An amber glow flooded the room from the red bulbs she had plugged into the overhead lamp. Harper's bedroom had a very different atmosphere from the rest of her small apartment. This was her safe place. Her sacred place. Colorful prints were scotch-taped to the room's walls. One was a Picasso. Another print was from Salvador Dalí's classic period. On her left side was a large bookshelf. It didn't have a single book in it. Her sister's urn sat on the middle shelf beside a framed picture of the both of them. Harper had taken the photo years ago on Long Beach, after their mother died from the same disease that would take Megan. They were sitting on a waterfront patio, drinking tea. They both had blue eyes and a face full of freckles. Although they'd been heartbroken at the time, they had their arms wrapped around each other, each trying to be strong for the other. Now, Megan was gone, and Harper was alone.
What should I do, Megan?
She whispered. She touched one of the many succulent plants that were arranged in a circle around the urn. She felt its silky surface glide against her finger. Her simple life, the one where she worried about her bills and her debt, seemed like a distant memory now. Gone with it was the feeling that this was her safe place, and that her life was on a mundane but secure path. The Recruits. Jordan. Jordan never dreamed he'd enjoy France this much. It stood against everything he believed in. Or everything they programmed me to believe in, he thought. I mean, the French are a bunch of cheese-eating surrender monkeys. He smiled. He liked that line. It was from an old TV show. Smiling at all was a welcomed change for Jordan. A lot had changed for him in the last 18 months. The ambush, the trauma, the aftermath. Executive command had blamed him for the disastrous raid, of course. He agreed he'd made some mistakes, but he'd thought the army was a brotherhood. One for all for one, and all that shit. Instead, they'd fucked him, turned their backs on him, made him their fall guy, and destroyed his psyche and his career. Still, it was amazing how a person could rebuild. His French shrink called it metanoia. Whatever it was, it had surprised Jordan. He never imagined he'd make it out of the fiasco with his sanity intact. Yet, here he was on the Seine, watching swans drift by as the wind swept back his light brown hair. The air smelled of fresh lilacs. The pace was slow, and the people were nice. Better still, for the first time in his life, he was alone. No one depending on him, no one to save. He sipped his café français, a mix of coffee and cognac, as a text box appeared in his vision. Video call, unknown origin. Damn, I should have left the earpiece at home, he thought. Jordan considered ignoring the call. He never answered calls from unknown origins, but it could be one of his new French friends. Answer, he sighed. Make opacity 40%. Jordan took a deep breath. Buongiorno, he exclaimed with an exaggerated French accent. His brother's translucent image appeared in his vision. Jordan groaned and felt his mood plummet. Ethan was the last person he wanted to hear from. It's about Dad. What? Jordan asked sarcastically. Did they make him president already? Jesus, you haven't heard anything? Jordan gulped his café français and watched as a French boy dashed across the boardwalk toward a woman wearing a blue dress. The woman glared at Jordan suspiciously. He understood her apprehension. France had categorically rejected IID implants, and most of their citizens didn't use the devices. But Jordan did. And to that woman, he was a strange man with wires sticking out of his head, talking into thin air. No, Ethan, he answered. Who would I be hearing from? And besides, I've been off the radar the past few weeks. And don't expect me to be concerned about dear old Dad, he thought. He's one of the reasons I'm out here on this self-imposed exile to begin with. Do you remember that, Ethan? You, little brother, you made the grade. Me? Not so much. Dad's been missing for days, his brother said. Well, Ethan, Jordan said wistfully, I'll let you know if he turns up. Behind his brother's image, he saw that the French boy had reached his mother now, and they began strolling along the boardwalk. It's so peaceful here, he thought. I think I'm going to hang up now, little brother. They know where Dad is. I'll be on the team going in to rescue him, and I want you with me. Jordan laughed. You may have heard.
I'm not in the military anymore.
Look, Ethan replied, I don't blame you for what happened.
Well, that makes one of you,
Jordan muttered and took another swig of his coffee.
Listen to me.
His brother was getting agitated. You and Dad might have had a falling out, but he's still our father and he's in big trouble.
Jordan, I need you to cover my back.
This one isn't exactly textbook.
Okay, okay, little brother, Jordan said, using a phrase he knew Ethan hated.
So where is Dad being held? Jordan took another sip as he listened, then spat out his coffee. After speaking with his brother, Jordan made arrangements for the next flight back to the States, but he was apprehensive about his decision. It had taken months to get himself returned to some version of normal. Now he was going to jump right back into the fire. And he was doing it for Ethan. Who would have thunk it? Jordan muttered to himself. A French couple passed him on the boardwalk and looked at him suspiciously. He scowled at them in response. The day's pleasant vibe was gone. His mood was sullen, and Jordan decided he was done taking anyone's scorn.
So what if I have IID sticking out of my head? He thought. Mind your own fucking business.
Jordan sighed and wondered why he suddenly felt like an outsider. That was something he had never experienced in his time in Paris.
Was it Ethan's call that changed it?
He shook his head.
That makes no sense, Jordan.
Still, the sky was becoming overcast, seeming to refute his own objection. His shoe heels clicked on the weathered boardwalk as he walked back to his pied-à-terre, the small apartment he rented. A cold wind blew up from the river, pressing his white shirt against his chest. It would be nightfall soon. He'd need to pack, then head to bed early for the morning flight. Another couple passed him, staring at him disdainfully.
What the fuck?
Jordan chuckled at the absurdity of it all.
Goddamn pathetic fallacy, he complained,
and that made him laugh out loud. Now the Parisians were giving him a wide berth. Jordan shook his head and chuckled again.
Call Francine,
he spoke into his mic, hoping to see one of his friends before he left Paris. In the lower right side of his field of vision, a text window appeared with the word, calling, flashing in blue. Jordan's pace slowed as he waited for her to answer. He gazed out at the Seine. It looked different now, less welcoming.
Pick up Francine,
he whispered. After 10 beeps, Jordan ended the call. He tried Henri next. Henri had been the first person to befriend him in Paris. He was a kind man, older than Jordan. The call went to Henri's personal message.
Bonjour. Vous êtes bien sûr le répondeur de Henri. Je ne peux pas vous répondre pour le moment.
Jordan disconnected the call without leaving a message.
Fucking figures,
he muttered. Before turning down his street, Jordan stopped at the Pont Alexandre III, a famous bridge that crossed the Seine.
One last moment to enjoy Paris,
he sighed. He gazed at the massive gilt bronze statues that decorated the edges of the bridge. They dated back to the 19th century. Their golden color gleamed brightly in the twilight. He stared at the contour of the statues and then gasped.
I'll be damned,
Jordan whispered. He stumbled onto the bridge, gaping at the statues. Although he'd seen them before, he'd never realized that they were sculpted, mythological creatures. As he shuffled along the bridge's walkway, nymphs, sea monsters, angels, and winged horses stared back at him from their iron and stone pedestals. 15 minutes later, Jordan stepped off the bridge, feeling disoriented, and walked down the street toward his apartment. White, ornate limestone buildings lined up on both sides of the cobblestone street. The scent of freshly baked bread made his mouth water. On the way, Jordan called his shrink and landlord, leaving messages for both of them. The sun was setting as he passed through the main wooden doors of his apartment building and climbed the stairs up to the 8th floor. Jordan walked into his kitchen, grabbing a glass of red wine and a piece of bread, then stepped out onto the tiny wraparound balcony that overlooked the street. The view was impressive. He stood near the edge of the black iron railing as the sun burst yellow hues across the Parisian metropolis. The Eiffel Tower, only 2 miles away, was the only structure that rose above the skyline of Haussmannian buildings. Jordan bit off some bread and washed it down with the cabernet. As he observed the city, the sun's rays changed to pink and then purple. A cool breeze drifted by, not chilling him this time, but refreshing him. The strange sensation that he was an outsider left him. He felt at home once again. He didn't want to leave France, and he knew it was solely his decision to make. But Ethan was the one who'd gotten him out of the mess in Nigeria after the failed raid. If it wasn't for him, Jordan would have faced a court-martial.
"And here I am,"
he muttered. Although he had spent most of his life clashing with Ethan, even hating him, he felt indebted to his brother now.
"Let that go," he whispered. "Do what's best for you, Jordan."
He scoffed at the idea. The last bands of purple vanished from the deep blue sky, and the lights on the Eiffel Tower switched on. Orange, yellow, and gold hues illuminated the steel structure. Jordan exhaled. He waited for what he knew was next. As the blue sky shifted to indigo, the Eiffel Tower lit up like a Christmas tree. Hundreds of sparkling lights flicked on, dancing and flickering throughout the structure. In the distance, he heard cheers rise from the streets. Jordan ate more bread and drank the wine.
"City of lights,"
he whispered. He stood there for another hour, ignoring the small wicker chairs that adorned the balcony. At one point, he tried to reach his friends again, but it was as if they'd disappeared. As the sky darkened and the tower shone more brilliantly, Jordan turned and walked back into his apartment to pack. The Mission. January 19th, 2073. Damon stood peering out the window from the 22nd floor. It was a cloudless morning, and despite the wintry weather outside, he could feel the sun's warm rays coming through the double-paned glass.
It felt nice.
Normal. He suspected he wouldn't experience normal again for a long time. He returned his gaze to the people at the table, 2 company reps, the senator's 2 entitled sons, and the chairperson of the Democratic National Committee. They'd gathered ahead of the 9 a.m. briefing.
The briefing before the briefing.
Damon mused.
"What makes you so certain Harris is in the virtual world?"
he asked. The Cloud9 CEO, a thin and balding man, groaned impatiently.
"Because there is a digital trail," he spoke in a British accent, "that leads to Noel McLaughlin, one of our engineers.
Noel received a considerable bank deposit and has since disappeared. We think he's the one who started up the infrastructure and sent Harris in.
Damon rubbed the stubble on his chin.
And you don't know where he's located in this virtual world?
Oliver Baker, the other company rep, grew restless now. No, as Mr. Walker pointed out, that was part of the breakdown. We can't control what happens outside the landing zone, and as such, he can't be detected.
Then why don't we just wait until he turns up at the landing zone?
A frustrated growl rose from the far side of the table. It was Ethan, one of the senator's sons.
Because he's the presumptive Democratic presidential nominee, you idiot!
Damon just smiled. He didn't want the sons on this mission, but that was out of his hands.
He's also in grave danger.
Carolyn Lindholm, the DNC chair, interjected. Not only from the creatures in the world, but from the glitches and mutations. In the center of the boardroom table, a metal device buzzed, and the image of a man's face appeared above it.
Mr. Walker, the rest of the team has arrived. They're waiting in room one.
We'll be right in,
the CEO replied. He looked at the group assembled.
Let's put a good face on these people.
When Harper arrived at the Cloud Nine Tower, she was still unsure about her decision. She'd spent most of the night tossing and turning. Harper needed the money. But she didn't want to die, and she didn't want to come back mutated.
Turn around. Turn around and go back home now.
She urged herself.
That was a laugh.
Yeah, back home to what? Home was a one-way ticket to nowhere. She had zero prospects and too much debt. What Cloud Nine was offering would solve all of her problems. She craned her neck to gaze at the top of the tower. Harper could barely make it out. Still undecided, she entered the building.
Stop! Who are you?
A harsh voice roared at her. Harper looked around and saw two armed security guards glaring at her from behind protective glass. Holy Fort Knox, she thought.
I'm very well, thanks, and how are you?
She smirked.
I'm Harper Benson.
Walk forward and insert those two IIDs.
Harper sighed. She stepped ahead into a glass gauntlet in the center of the lobby. Steel bars blocked her from entering the foyer. On her right, two wires were cradled in a black container. She pulled the wires and plugged the pins into her forehead IID inputs.
Harper Benson, biosignature 753224928051.
A computerized voice emitted. She yanked the pins from her head.
Happy now?
The steel bars receded with a heavy clang, and the same security guard scooted over to greet her.
Hi there, Harper. I'm Chad,
he said musically. I am so very pleased to meet you. I'm a big fan of your work. The guard's wild transformation stunned Harper. One moment he was eating nails, the next he was fawning over her.
Thanks, Chad. I thought you were going to kill me back there.
Chad laughed excitedly.
Oh, that's just our fierce facade.
He gestured to the other guard, who was sporting an enormous smile and waving his hand energetically from behind the glass cubicle. Harper waved back.
We're both big fans.
Chad giggled.
Okay, this is getting surreal now, she thought.
Chad, I'm here for a 9 o'clock meeting.
Oh, yes, yes.
Right this way, Asta.
Harper groaned. Chad escorted her to a bank of elevators and swiped his keycard across a screen embedded in the wall. As she stepped into the elevator, Harper glanced back outside at the brightening day. At that moment, she decided. For better or for worse, Chad had actually helped her. His silly display of admiration had lifted her mood.
Her fears about the dangers involved in transferring into an unstable game world had subsided.
It's time to move forward, she thought. It's time to improve my life.
Harper felt strong, in control, and she would accept their offer. Damon entered the second boardroom for the 9 a.m. briefing and was astonished by the difference. Unlike the first boardroom, this room was larger and fitted with the latest advanced technologies. He recognized the smart glass windows that encompassed two sides of the room. They had a blue tint that adjusted in opacity to correspond with the sun's position, keeping the room temperature well regulated. A translucent glass table sat in the center of the room. Corporate symbols glided across its dark blue surface. Damon spotted Angie at the end of the table. She was sitting beside Zack, who was wearing his full military fatigues. Damon smiled and shook his head.
Hey, Zack. You can't bring clothes with you on this trip.
Zack grinned and shrugged.
Hey, bro. Just representing the team.
Angie suppressed a laugh. She had a book opened in front of her. Angie was the only person Damon knew who still used tactile books.
What you reading? He asked.
Yeats.
Trying to memorize that stuff before we get shipped off?
She laughed.
You know it, Damo.
The rest of the Cloud Nine group shuffled into the room.
You're at the head of the table with me.
Walker whispered to Damon. The CEO tapped the table to turn off the video display, then stared at the 12 people gathered before him.
Clockwise, starting with me, he announced loudly. I am Paul Walker, and the reason you are here. The man to my left is Damon Williams, a special operations commander. He will be the team leader for this mission. To his left, Jana Bauman and Brett Miller. They are nurses from the New York General...
Nurses? Why the hell do we need nurses?
Someone asked derisively. Damon saw that it was Zack and his muscles clenched. Walker glanced at Damon impatiently.
Zack?
Damon growled.
Shut up and listen. You'll understand soon enough.
Zack settled back in his chair.
All right, all right.
Walker thanked Damon and continued with the crew list.
Emma Taylor, a programmer from New York. Harper Benson, a gaming champion, also from New York. Miguel Lopez, another gaming champ from San Jose.
Angie, Zack, Ethan, Jordan, Oliver Baker, and Carolyn Lindholm, the DNC chair, filled out the right side of the table. Walker tapped the table once more, and old video footage of Epiphany 16 displayed across its surface.
You will be entering Epiphany 16, he said, a first-generation quantum MMORPG. Designed as a theme park for families and game enthusiasts, Epiphany was shut down 8 years ago after it developed...
He searched for the right word.
After it started developing complications. These complications will affect your mission.
Walker got up and walked to the window. Damon followed and stood rigidly beside him. The CEO touched the smart glass, which darkened, leaving the room with minimal lighting. Text appeared on the glass surface.
1. No respawns. The dangers are real. You can die on Epiphany 16.
2. Intensified emotional response. Due to Epiphany's systemic breakdown, your emotional reactions will be heightened. Each recruit has undergone a full psychological evaluation.
3. Pain filtering. Due to the same breakdown, pain is at 100%.
4. Temporal mutation. Incursions must be limited to 20 days, followed by 2 days back at the campus for observation. 5. IID retrofit.
Damon, Zach, and Angie are scheduled for 11 a.m. insertion. 6. Race, class, and stat selections. Performed during the setup phase, you will receive digital and print handouts detailing your choices. 7. Epiphany 16 Realms. You may find Harris in any of these realms, but you must complete them in order: Earth, Water, Fire, Ice, Sky, Horror, Divine, Time.
Hey, that's not right, Harper protested. The limit is 10 days, not 20.
Walker glanced at her, visibly annoyed.
Ms. Harper, not everything you hear on your message board is true. I assure you will be fine if you stay within the 20-day allowance.
Miguel raised his hand.
I've heard it's 10 days too, and I've seen the videos of the mutated people. Why should we trust you?
Walker regarded Miguel with a vulpine smile.
You don't have to,
he responded coldly.
If you're unsure of the facts, you may leave now. Your replacements are waiting in the wings, and they will receive your money.
Miguel slumped in his chair.
Are there any other questions?
The CEO asked. No one responded. Walker smiled.
And finally, to answer Zachary's earlier query, we have Jenna and Brett because, as nurses, they will be assigned to the healer class.
Damon stepped forward.
So because of the temporal mutation, we now have 14 days to find the senator before he begins to mutate.
As the recruits left the boardroom for their designated quarters, Harper rushed to Damon and Walker, who were standing by the door.
Can we overpower our base stats?
She asked. Damon turned to the CEO.
Overpower?
Walker shifted uncomfortably and loosened his silk tie.
Because of the glitches, we can't go above base level, he replied. Your stats start at level 1, and your hit points will vary from 31 to 87, depending on your race selection.
Although to accommodate non-gamers, Walker continued, leveling up on Epiphany is relatively quick and easy. You will gain a level for every 25 experience points. He glanced at Damon, who was struggling to follow the conversation.
Once you reach level 50, the process changes, requiring more experience to gain levels. Starting at level 51, you will need 10% more XP for each level.
Harper groaned.
However, different metrics govern the creatures you will encounter.
Walker said.
Their health and mana totals are 1/10 of their constitution and intelligence stats.
The CEO turned to Damon.
You and Miss Benson should have a discussion.
Walker quickly exited the room. Damon glanced at Harper and was struck by her fierce blue eyes.
Let's sit for a minute,
she said, and motioned toward the boardroom table. They returned to the table.
As with many role-playing games, Harper said, we have to gain experience points to improve our stats. Right now, our numbers are going to be awfully low, putting us at a big disadvantage.
Harper paused. Our race and class choices affect the character metrics. The most important metric will be hit points, or HP, meaning our life energy.
So we can just pick the character with the most hit points?
Damon asked.
She shook her head. No, it's not that simple. Other metrics will affect our success as well. Staying alive will depend on the individual strengths of the group.
She hesitated.
Can I make a proposal?
Yes, please do.
Miguel and I can decide the class and race selections for the team. If the members agree with our choices, Cloud9 can start assigning those metrics.
Damon smiled.
For such a young person, you sure know how to take charge, he thought. How long do you need?
Well, assuming I can find Miguel in his quarters, we'll have the selections ready after your surgery.
Ethan sat at the table with Jordan, surveying the empty cafeteria. It was a dingy place.
I guess Cloud9 only spends the big bucks on rooms that are intended to impress,
Ethan thought. At the cafeteria's far corner, he noticed a pair of mice skittering across the table, searching for a morsel of food. He glanced at the mound of congealed mush on Jordan's plate.
How's your beef bourguignon?
Jordan looked up with a sardonic smile.
I miss France.
Ethan laughed. Things were better between them now. They'd had a chance to talk through some of their issues. It hadn't always been that way. From early on, Jordan had considered Ethan his rival. Jordan had been the only child, the center of attention, basking in his parents' love. Then along came Ethan, stealing attention away. Ethan had flourished, becoming intelligent and gifted as an athlete. Meanwhile, Jordan's development plateaued. The low point had come in their early teens when their father, Will, insisted they sign up for organized hockey, expecting it would help the brothers bond. To spite his father, Jordan signed with a different team. A couple of months later, during an exhibition game, Jordan cross-checked his brother into the boards. Ethan got up and punched Jordan in the face. They fought. It was brief, but fierce. Jordan knocked out one of Ethan's teeth, and that seemed to be the start of a growing divide between Jordan and Will. A few years later, Will endorsed the brothers for admission into the USNA, but the Naval Academy rejected Jordan's application while accepting Ethan's. Will was furious, but the Academy wouldn't budge. Soon afterward, Jordan met with a recruiter and signed up for the Army instead. After basic training ended, they stationed him in Nigeria, where he excelled, and fell in love with a local woman named Abebe. He added structure to his life and escaped the relentless gaze of his father. Within a few years, Jordan rose to the specialist rank. Then, on an October night, he was assigned to a team ordered to take out a Boko Haram stronghold in Sokoto. But the terrorist group had been waiting for them. They shot down 2 helicopters and killed 13 team members. The army concluded that Abebe was an informant and blamed Jordan for the ambush. Ethan pulled enough strings to keep Jordan out of prison, but his military career was over. Meanwhile, Abebe terminated contact with Jordan. Later, Jordan would learn from a Nigerian friend that the Boko Haram killed Abebe. At that time, Jordan was back in the States and in therapy for severe depression and post-traumatic stress disorder. After a few months, he flew to Europe, vowing never to speak to the family again. Ethan saw that the mice had found their food. They jumped off the table and dashed across the dirty floor. He reached across the table and grabbed his brother's arm.
Jordan, I'm sorry for everything you've been through. Command should have stood behind you. Fuck it, Dad should have stood behind you. That wasn't right. Goddamned politics. If Mom was around, she would have set him straight.
Ethan scoffed. You know, he continued, Dad's been weird since we lost her. And now this.
Just sheer stupidity.
Jordan's eyes were watering.
Thanks, Ethan.
He choked. They ate in silence for several minutes under the heavy cloud of their shared history. Ethan knew his brother had suffered, and he could feel the weight of it now. A janitor strolled by, cleaning the cafeteria floor with a gray mop. He peeked at the brothers, recognizing them, but said nothing.
Ethan was relieved. He glanced at Jordan, who looked miserable.
"Do you think we'll find Dad?"
Jordan asked.
"We'll find him."
"Do you think we'll find him before the end of his 20 days?"
Ethan regarded his brother.
"We have to, Jordan."
"Right," Jordan said with a hollow laugh. "The Democratic National Convention is this July. I don't care about the politics, and I don't care if this costs him the nomination. I just want our father back."
Jordan nodded and started fiddling with his food.
"Have you seen the videos that Gamer Kid was talking about?"
he asked quietly. Ethan turned and gazed out the cafeteria's dusty window.
"Yes, I have. And they make me sick."
In the faint light of his room, Miguel lay on the bed staring at his old tablet. The lava lamp he'd brought with him sat on a computer desk, the red blobs circled within its glass casing. Cloud9 wouldn't allow their ear devices, so he couldn't view the stat sheets through his visual display. Miguel studied the files on the tablet, trying to decide between going in as a mage or a hunter. He suspected the military members would lock up the warrior classes. That made sense.
"The military members are a problem,"
he thought. They were not game players. In fact, most of the team wasn't. They'd need to be brought up to speed, and even then, they were going to be liabilities. If it was his choice, which it wasn't, he'd fill the team with veteran gamers. A tap on his door interrupted his thoughts. Miguel stood and opened it.
"We need to talk,"
Harper said. She stood in his doorway, her eyes reflecting red from the lamp's glow. Miguel couldn't help himself.
"Hasta la vista, baby."
She snickered.
"Nice to meet you, Master Miguel, #39.
Miguel laughed, pleasantly surprised that she knew his avatar name. He noticed her tablet and nodded toward it.
"Great minds think alike."
She peered over his shoulder and saw his tablet lying on the bed.
"Fools seldom differ,"
she said, grinning. Miguel chuckled.
"After you, Asta,"
he replied, gesturing ceremoniously to his room. The living quarters for each recruit were the same. One bed, a small fridge, a bathroom on the right, a sink counter at the end, and a venerable bit-based computer balancing on a desk by the sink. Harper saw the lava lamp.
"Nice touch."
She entered the room, sat on the bed, and picked up his tablet.
"Going through the specs?"
"Uh-huh. Have you heard what the other members are choosing?"
"That, my friend, will be up to us."
She patted the space beside her. Miguel remained at the door for a moment, stunned by Harper's beauty. He walked to the bed and sat next to her. He could smell a sweet perfume rising from her. This close, he could see each strand of her shoulder-length brown hair. The lava lamp's red light gave her skin a warm glow. His knees wanted to jackhammer, but he was determined to keep them still.
"Based on our game-playing experience," she said, "Damon wants us to make the selections. Let's use your tablet."
Reaching for his tablet, her arm brushed against his. Miguel felt the soft hairs on her forearm flutter over his skin.
"We have 3 races and 4 classes to choose from," she said, scrolling through his tablet. "With 10 people to assign. I think 3 of the military members should be warriors. They're best suited to it. What do you think?"
Miguel caught himself gazing at her. He cleared his throat and agreed.
"Let's assign Damon, Zack, and Ethan to the Valhallan race and the warrior class," she suggested. "I've talked to Angie, and she agreed to be a hunter. I'm hoping to convince Jordan to do the same. They're both on the smaller side and are less suitable for tanking.
Angie told me she does yoga and...
Harper noticed Miguel staring at her, glassy-eyed.
Are you all right?
She placed her palm on his thigh, and electricity surged through Miguel's body.
Oh, your fingers are so warm,
he thought. He tried to smile casually.
Yeah, I'm just following along. You've put a lot of thought into this.
She smiled at him, removed her hand, and continued.
Emma Taylor, the programmer, has gaming experience, so let's make her a hunter.
She placed his tablet on the bed and glanced at him.
That leaves the mage class to you and me.
What do you think?
Miguel took a breath. I think that's great. The hunters should be the Grimalkin race.
Harper shook her head.
Angie doesn't want to be a cat.
Miguel chuckled.
She won't be a cat. She'll be, a cat-like humanoid.
He replied indignantly. She shook her head again.
Uh-uh.
She can't get over the cat thing. He sighed.
Wow, these are not gamers. We're going to have our hands full.
She nodded and looked around the room. So, where did you find the lava lamp?
I found it at a second-hand store. It was broken, but I patched it back together.
He peeked at her sheepishly.
Fixing things is sort of a hobby of mine.
She nodded reassuringly.
What about you?
He asked.
What are you into?
She laughed. Well, it's not fixing things. I suppose my hobby is paying off my student debt. She glanced at Miguel and bit her lip sheepishly.
That and, disco music.
Miguel exploded with laughter.
Disco? You're into disco? Oh my God!
He fell over on the bed, trailing off. Harper nodded and grumbled. Yeah, 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 have your fun, have your fun. When he stopped laughing, she poked him with her finger.
All right, Mr. Music Critic, what are you into?
Miguel grinned mischievously.
Boy bands,
he whispered.
Harper erupted. Oh, you fucker,
she howled, slapping his shoulder. Why, you little... You mean like the newer kids on the block and the millennial boys? He nodded, still grinning.
You fucker! I think you already said that,
Miguel quipped.
Yeah, I love all that sappy shit,
he said excitedly. I even listen to the older music like the Pear Tree family.
The what family?
She asked, laughing. He looked at her with mock disdain.
Never mind. You're obviously much too young for my cultured tastes.
Harper belly laughed and leaned against him. She looked up at him sweetly, and he wondered if she was feeling something too.
Please, please, please.
Too young, eh?
I'm older than you, wise guy, she said.
Miguel gazed down at her, but didn't answer. She was right, of course. Harper was 5 years his senior. As she leaned against him, he wondered why he found her so alluring.
There's something about you. An energy, an aura, he thought.
She sat up straight. Okay, wise guy, back to the task at hand.
Point allocation.
What are your views on min-max? They continued for another 30 minutes, discussing the 20 extra stat points each member received. Miguel was an active participant in the conversation, but his mind was elsewhere. Later, she would rest her hand on his leg again and send him back into an infatuated swoon. As they wrapped up, Harper grabbed her tablet and strolled to the door. They chatted, exchanging pleasantries. But for Miguel, the decision seemed distant, almost muted, like they were underwater. She smiled at him, and he watched as her cheek dimpled.
He faintly heard them say goodbye, but he was lost in the visceral moment, his mind inundated with one singular thought. I want you.
Walker heard the knock on his open door and knew it was her. He looked up. Carolyn Lindholm, the DNC chair, stood in his doorway.
How did the grunt surgery go, Paul?
She asked. Walker smirked and asked her to close the door. She obliged and sat at Walker's desk.
Flying colors, my dear lady.
Walker answered. They were in and out within 40 minutes, which leaves us on track for the 2 p.m. transfer. Carolyn exhaled.
That's good, Paul. Have they discussed strategy with you?
No, and I'm not interested. I've told them what they're required to know, that they will need to hunt for food and must take the realms consecutively.
Walker flashed a predatory smile. After that.
Well, as the saying goes, that is why they get paid the big bucks.
Carolyn glared at the CEO. She knew Walker disliked her, and he didn't hide it. She felt the same about him, but kept her feelings to herself. She had bigger issues at hand.
Paul, we need to get Will out of there.
He nodded.
I know, Carolyn.
Walker didn't care about the senator. He was a Republican, after all. What he did care about was the DNC money that started pouring in once the party learned of the senator's whereabouts. The DNC was justifiably freaking out over the prospect of the senator's self-indulgent misadventure going public. But that was good for Cloud Nine. It kept the money flowing. Carolyn stood and walked to the door, then hesitated, glancing back at Walker.
Are you sure you don't want to send in the second team?
Walker shook his head.
No, Carolyn. As I have already explained, he replied derisively, the second team will only get in the way, and besides,
he flashed his vulpine smile. His pale eyes shimmered coldly.
We need the second team to fill in for casualties.
Beginning stats. Jordan. Race. Grimalkin. Class. Hunter. HP. 51. HPR. 0.68. MP. 24. MPR. 0.6. Strength. 36. Constitution. 34. Dexterity. 25. Intelligence. 31. Wisdom. 30. Endurance. 12. Emma. Race. Grimalkin. Class. Hunter. HP. 51. HPR. 0.68. MP, 24. MPR, 0.6. Strength, 36. Constitution, 34. Dexterity, 25. Intelligence, 31. Wisdom, 30. Endurance, 12. Jenna. Race, human. Class, healer. HP, 31. HPR, 0.42. MP, 41. MPR, 1.14. Strength, 15. Constitution, 21. Dexterity, 19. Intelligence, 52. Wisdom, 57. Endurance, 23. Brett. Race. Human. Class. Healer. HP, 31. HPR, 0.42. MP,
41. MPR, 1.14. Strength, 15. Constitution, 21. Dexterity, 19. Intelligence, 52. Wisdom, 57. Endurance, 23. Miguel. Race, human. Class, mage. HP, 31. HPR, 0.42. MP, 41. MPR, 1.14. Strength, 15. Constitution, 21. Dexterity, 19. Intelligence, 52. Wisdom, 57. Endurance, 23. Harper. Race, human. Class, mage. HP, 31. HPR, 0.42. MP, 41. MPR, 1.14. Strength, 15. Constitution, 21. Dexterity, 19. Intelligence, 52. Wisdom, 57. Endurance, 23. Angie. Race, human. Class, hunter. HP, 46. HPR, 0.62. MP, 33. MPR, 0.94. Strength, 25. Constitution, 31. Dexterity, 19. Intelligence, 42. Wisdom, 47. Endurance, 23. Zach. Race, Valhallan Orc. Class, warrior. HP, 102. HPR, 1.36. MP, 8. MPR, 0.24. Strength, 50. Constitution, 68. Dexterity, 15. Intelligence, 10. Wisdom, 12. Endurance, 8. Damon, Valhallan Orc. Class, warrior. HP, 102. HPR, 1.36. MP, 8. MPR, 0.24. Strength, 50. Constitution, 68. Dexterity, 15. Intelligence, 10. Wisdom, 12. Endurance, 8. Ethan. Race, Valhallan Orc. Class, warrior. HP, 102. HPR, 1.36. MP, 8. MPR, 0.24. Strength, 50. Constitution, 68. Dexterity, 15. Intelligence, 10. Wisdom, 12. Endurance, 8.
Final preparations. Following the implant surgery, the 10 recruits reconvened in the boardroom they had used earlier. They gathered around the blue glass table with tablets, stat sheets, and paper plates. A buffet of different foods covered the center of the table. Roasted chicken and potatoes, baked pasta, nachos, Indian and Chinese food, hamburgers and fries. The DNC had catered the food, taking a pass on the cafeteria's offerings.
"Hey, Brett, have you tried this Indian food?"
Jana asked her fellow nurse.
"It is incredible."
Through his full mouth, Brett mumbled his agreement.
Yeah, I'm saying I haven't eaten food like this in a while,
Zack said, glancing at Damon.
But then I've tasted better. You know what I'm saying?
Janna watched Zack shove food into his mouth.
Well, you pound back the stuff like there's no tomorrow, she said casually.
Zack grinned.
I'd rather be eating something else.
His grin widened.
But, right now I'm thinking food.
She rolled her eyes. Damon tapped a fork on his plastic glass, producing a clinking sound.
It's 12:30, and we don't have much time, so Harper, Miguel, can you start while the kids eat?
At the head of the table, Harper glanced at Miguel. Once we arrive on Epiphany, she started, menu screens will appear in your field of vision. You can toggle these screens off with just a thought like a... Harper hesitated, unsure how to finish.
Like a determination, a force of your will,
Miguel interjected.
Right, Harper said.
And among those interfaces are your main settings, which brings us to the first point. She looked around the table. Because they designed Epiphany as a family attraction, Cloud9 wanted customers to be able to contact each other anywhere in the realms, so they added a telepathy function. As a result, while we're on Epiphany, we can communicate telepathically. The team stopped eating.
You mean communicate with our minds, right?
Angie asked.
Yes,
Harper replied. There was a murmur among the recruits. Harper went on, saying,
Next, we've consulted with you about your race, class, and point assignments, and here are the designations.
Miguel followed Harper as she walked to the smart window and tapped on it. The members' stats appeared.
Ethan laughed. I have no idea what any of those stats mean.
Harper nodded. Miguel and I will oversee that, but FYI, strength is not what it sounds like. Constitution is your health. Endurance affects your stamina. Dexterity is your speed and agility. Intelligence influences your MP limit and your spell potency. Wisdom affects your mana point regeneration, or MPR, but it also represents your willpower. She paused. We've allocated your 20 extra stat points into specific stat categories. They are in italics. The recruits were losing interest, focusing more on the food than the would-be mages at the head of the table. Harper sighed. Your HP and MP totals are percentages of your other stat totals. Your hit points are 150% of your constitution stat. Your HP regen rate, or HPR, is 2% of the same stat. As you level up, all your stats will increase. Harper glanced at her fellow mage. Miguel will discuss your mana points. He stepped forward.
Mana is a universal force that enables you to cast spells. Your mana totals and regen rates are calculated from your intelligence and wisdom stats.
He looked around the table.
Until you get accustomed to the system, trust our advice.
Harper continued.
The race selections will influence your stats and physical shape. They are game interpretations of who you are. For instance, the humans will have bigger eyes and longer legs, but...
She surveyed the room.
Angie, you'll still have that long curly hair.
She sighed.
Brett, you'll keep those high cheekbones.
Only Damon and Miguel seemed to be paying attention now. She looked over at Miguel for support. He cleared his throat loudly.
Your class section will determine your weapons, armor, and spells. The orcs will be equipped with pink shirts and will have watermelon catapults for weapons.
Harper stifled a laugh. The team members gaped at them. Some were grinning.
Yeah, so you better listen up,
Harper scolded, because we can make that happen. Miguel started chuckling. Harper exhaled and looked at Damon.
That's it for now.
Damon stood.
One more thing. We'll communicate by video with the Cloud9 control team through the landing zone only. They will be constantly monitoring that feed.
He surveyed the recruits.
Okay. We have about an hour remaining. Let's meet in the transfer room at 1:45.
Harper and Miguel walked along the long corridor back to their rooms. Cloud9 had given the recruits the entire ninth floor, which consisted of 55 lodging rooms. With only 10 recruits, the company spaced out the room assignments. Harper glanced at Miguel and squeezed his hands.
Thanks for your help back there.
You're welcome.
Pink skirts, eh?
Harper teased. Miguel laughed, and his face turned red.
You're forgetting the watermelon catapults.
She slowed and turned to him.
Did you ever think we'd be in charge of a military team?
He shrugged.
We're not. Damon is.
Harper found his hand again, and they stopped. She shook his head.
Oh, no, 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 my young friend. Damon has deferred that responsibility to you and me.
He gaped at her, speechless.
Listen, Miguel, we're going into a very dangerous situation, she said.
He'll command the grunts, but the coordination of the group and strategy will fall to us. Her fingers skimmed over the inside of his palm, and Miguel felt traitorous beads of sweat rise from his pores.
Harper, do you think you're up for that?
She laughed.
I signed up like everyone else, she replied,
not answering his question. They started walking again.
How about you?
She asked. He considered it for a moment.
I'm going to approach it like any other game, I suppose.
She glanced at him, perplexed by his answer.
Yeah, one where you could actually die,
she said soberly.
Yes. One where we can die.
In his small gray room, Damon sat at the old computer. He was studying the stats and images of the Valhallan orcs. They were god-awful ugly. To him, they looked like a cross between a human and a pig. But they were enormous, brimming with muscle, and he liked their plate armor, too. It looked both flexible and strong. Damon heard a knock at the door. He got up and opened it. Angie stood in the doorway, wearing a long red dress. Being a soldier, Angie was very muscular, but she was still endowed with gorgeous curves. Seeing that she had his attention, Angie performed a little wiggle. He smiled at her.
You packed some extra clothes?
She nodded seductively.
Hey, soldier, how about one last bump in the hay before we get shipped off to Super Mario World?
Sure. You have 20 new holes I can use, he teased, nodding at her implants.
She lowered her head and rolled her eyes at him. Very funny, Romeo.
Please, come in, he said. He watched Angie slip off her shoes, close the door, and saunter by him. As she passed, he could smell her hair. It smelled of cinnamon and reminded him of the nights they would stay up talking well into the morning. She would sip her cinnamon tea while he drank black coffee. It had taken a lot of nights, but she'd eventually opened up to him. She'd initially been cautious, given Damon's history, but he persevered. Still, she wasn't ready to commit to him long term. This was his chance. They would find the idiot politician, and he would persuade her then. She looked at him, her eyes glistening.
Come on, we have a little time,
she said, tugging at his shirt. He pulled his shirt off, showing off his new implants. She touched one.
Do they hurt?
Not a bit.
Yeah, me neither.
The wonders of science, Angie, he said with a playful smile. Her hands unbuckled his belt. Damon watched her and felt the body heat radiating from her light cocoa skin.
He kissed her and savored her familiar, slightly salty taste. She nudged him away and motioned to the bed, gazing at him with a wry smile.
Is that thing going to hold the two of us?
He uttered a small laugh.
I guess we'll find out. We'll be lucky if it doesn't squeak.
She giggled. They spent the next 20 minutes reconnecting to each other, and the bed did indeed squeak. Afterward, Angie whispered into his ear,
"After this mission, let's build our home, be together."
Damon smiled up at her.
"I love you, Angel."
She told him that she loved him too.
"Everything is falling into place," he thought.
It was going to be perfect. Cloud Nine was going to set them up for life. All they had to do was complete this one mission. Walker and the DNC delegation arrived 30 minutes early to the basement-level transfer room. He wanted to make sure everything was arranged perfectly. The room had been retrofitted to allow for the large-scale transfer. They'd linked 10 pods and lined them up in two rows of five. A TV screen showing the Epiphany 16 landing zone was positioned below the white concrete ceiling. Beside the screen were two small speakers. Five workers wearing white lab coats stood by the pods silently. Walker had told the crew he wanted the room spotless, and they did not disappoint. Walker gazed through a section of smoked glass at the technicians in the main control room. He had informed the techs of all the details, including the backup team waiting on the 10th floor. If a recruit pulled out at the last minute, it would be a quick switch to their replacement. Walker peered over his shoulder at Carolyn Lindholm. The damn woman had returned from lunch with her delegation, insisting they be included. Since then, the delegation had followed him around like a needy lapdog.
"Bloody Americans,"
Walker thought.
"Miss Wilson,"
he said, smiling fraudulently,
"would you and your esteemed guests like to observe the transfer from the control room?"
He gestured toward the smoked glass.
"You can watch everything from the seats behind the panel. Take a load off, as they say."
Carolyn surveyed Walker suspiciously, then consulted with her colleagues. There were four of them, one of whom was morbidly obese.
"Yes, take a load off by all means," Walker thought, "before your fat friend breaks his ankles, my dear lady."
She turned back to him.
"Yes, that would be nice. We'd probably get in the way anyway."
"My dear lady, you already have,"
Walker thought coldly. He escorted them to the control room, which was dimly lit but warmer than the cold transfer room. At the front of the room, three people sat at a control panel full of buttons and levers. Fastened to the wall above them were two cameras pointed at the technicians. Another monitor hung from the ceiling, displaying the landing zone. Behind the control panel were a dozen theater-type seats. Walker gestured toward the seats.
"There you are. You can view all the festivities and the inner workings from here. Much more comfortable than the concrete floor, don't you agree?"
The delegation concurred and sat behind the panel. Walker escaped back to the transfer room just in time to greet Harper, Miguel, Ethan, and Jordan.
"Welcome, welcome, welcome, my friends," the CEO exclaimed. "Please, make yourselves comfortable."
Harper glanced around the room, then looked at Miguel. The room was barren except for the 10 pods. He shrugged.
"I suppose we can sit on the end of the pods,"
he whispered. They walked to the pods, and the brothers followed.
"What's with the lab monkeys, Ethan?"
Jordan whispered, gesturing to the crew.
"They haven't moved an inch."
Ethan nodded.
"Yeah, that's weird."
Walker pranced over to the lab workers and spoke with them. They dispersed and approached the team members. A familiar voice sang from the doorway.
Ground control to Major fucking Tom, man.
Harper turned to see Zack, hands on his hips, fascinated by the room despite its modest arrangement. Brett, Janna, and Emma waited behind him. Harper leaned over to Miguel's pod.
Doesn't take much to impress him,
she whispered. He chuckled. Damon and Angie walked in next, and Walker assembled the 10 recruits in front of the pods.
My dear friends, you have been given a task of great import, he said, raising his arms ceremoniously. The state of our democracy rests in your capable hands, but your mission is not without peril. You must rely on each other as a team to survive. All the while, we will be here to attend to your every need.
He pointed at the TV screen hanging from the ceiling.
Our control team will monitor the landing zone on a 24-hour basis. From the landing zone, you will access the portal room. That is where your adventure begins and our communications end. I hope you will find the senator soon. Do you have questions?
The group was silent.
Very well. Let's remain on schedule and get you hooked up. As you will need to remove your clothes, I would ask that the four ladies proceed to the back row.
Walker laughed sarcastically.
I know how you men like to gawk at members of the female persuasion.
He studied the six men.
Mr. Williams, you strike me as a man of honor, so you may join the ladies in the back row, the rest of the men in front. Now, drop your clothing to the floor and lay on the pods.
The recruits glanced at each other uncomfortably. No one moved. Walker waited, relishing the members' awkwardness. Finally, Zack broke the ice.
Last one in the pool is a dirty, rotten egg,
he said as he stripped. The other members slowly began undressing. In the left corner of the room, Damon reached for Angie as they laid on the pods. She took his hand, glanced at him, and smiled. His eyes were fixed straight up at the ceiling. One of the lab monkeys approached Damon.
Hi, I'm Shelley. How are you today?
She asked as she inserted pins into his IIDs. He reciprocated the greeting but felt ridiculous doing it. To his left, Harper shuddered.
Damn, it's cold in here,
she whispered. In the front row, most of the men lay in their pods, except for one straggler, Brett. The big male nurse slowly and meticulously removed his clothing. As he settled onto his pod, he craned his head just enough to see the women behind him. Having had a good look at Harper and Angie, he brought his gaze back and found Zack staring at him.
You asshole,
Zack whispered. Brett grinned and stared at the ceiling.
I apologize for the frigid temperature, my friends, Walker stated loudly. And for your embarrassment, but you will be clothed upon your arrival at the landing zone.
His heels clicked across the concrete floor.
Now, if you may excuse me, I will converse with you from the control room.
Walker and the lab monkeys quickly exited the room, leaving the team recruits alone in the room. Miguel sat up.
What the hell?
He asked. Walker's staticky and distorted voice rang through the speakers.
Please lay down, Mr. Lopez. Everything is in order.
Miguel settled back onto his pod.
Ladies and gentlemen, your vitals are within standard limits and you are ready for departure. If anyone doesn't feel prepared, please raise your hand.
A long silence hung in the air. No one raised their hand.
Very well, my friends. I wish you good luck and Godspeed. Your adventure begins in 5, 4.
Angie looked up at the white ceiling.
This is it,
she thought.
3, 2, 1.
Zack heard a deafening buzzing noise that grew higher in pitch. A worried murmur rose among the recruits. The sound grew louder and higher still, producing an accelerating feedback loop. Zack instinctively reached up to cover his ears, then felt his body lose its cohesion. He looked down and gasped. His body wavered between translucency and opaqueness. "What the fuck?" he exclaimed. Faintly, he could hear Walker's panicked voice ringing through the speakers. "Have to lie still, Zack. Lower your..." He tried to put his arms down, but he felt like he was in a dream state. His movements were suddenly very slow. Zack watched as his arms fluctuated between solid and transparent. In that span, he saw his arteries, organs, and skeleton. Finally, his arms touched the pod again. He peered to his right to see if anyone else was experiencing problems. The recruits were gone. "Why am I still here?" he wondered miserably. White-hot pain shot through his left arm. He looked down and couldn't see his body anymore. "I've become invisible," he marveled. Then he saw his left forearm. It was the only part of his body he could still see. That, and the blood. Lots of blood. As the feedback intensified and the pain grew worse, Zack closed his eyes. Part 2. The Crucible. Pale were the sweet lips I saw, pale were the lips I kissed, and fair the form I floated with about that melancholy storm. On a Dream. William Butler Yeats. "Come on, girl, I got the disease. Come on, girl, it's scary for sure. Come on, girl, I'm down on my knees. Come on, girl, this love's got no cure." The Pear Tree Family. Rude Awakening. The transition to the realms was brief in real time. It was a dreamy state that elicited feelings of contentment and happiness for most of the team members, except for Harper. She found herself back on Nuclear Nights. She had disposed of Bigfoot, Bjorn, and Silo. The only competitors left were the noobs, but there were a lot of them, and they were all slow-moving zombies. "Gonna be easy pickings," she thought. She blasted the closest zombie, and it lit up like a torch. The zombie noob, a guy who went by the name of Awesome Andrew 537, continued toward her. Harper expected that. The zombies were easy to vanquish, but they took a long time to snuff out. They were big trouble if they got close to you, as their touch would change your status to cursed and poisoned. Then, of course, there was the chewing your flesh off part. But if you kept your distance, their hit points just continued dwindling. A rotted hand settled onto her shoulder. Harper spun around and saw her dead sister. Megan's blue eyes were now a milky gray. The corpse raised its other arm and placed it on Harper's other shoulder, pulling her close. Harper's fingers loosened, and she dropped the plasma rifle. The Megan thing struggled to open its mouth, but its lips were fused together by years of decay. Harper watched as its jaws opened and skin stretched where her sister's mouth used to be. The lips suddenly ripped apart with a snapping sound, flinging pieces of skin at her. Harper recoiled in horror as a black tongue fell out of the monster's mouth. "My brother!" The thing croaked. The smell of old rot drifted from its yawning mouth. Harper became oblivious to the noobs battling around her. The game no longer mattered.
"Marper!"
It moaned.
"Listen!"
Its fingers tightened painfully on her shoulders. One eye swiveled while the other eyeball stared fixedly ahead.
Brummy abs.
The thing urged. The zombie shook Harper's shoulders.
Brummy abs.
The Megan thing rocked her violently, repeating its weird chant. Its fingers curled in and pierced her skin. Harper felt warm blood trickle down her shoulders. She looked down and saw it flowing into a strange scar just below her collarbone. Where did I get that scar? She thought. Harper struggled to pull away from the zombie. The Megan thing gripped her tightly. She twisted her body to loosen its grasp, but the thing held her like a vice.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.